Nocking points. How do you measure them? What are the differences between a tied-on nocking point and a brass nocking point? One versus two. Should they be touching? Should they not? We'll cover all these things in this video today. If you're new here, my name is Jay Kaminsky. I'm a two-time Olympic silver medalist in the sport of archery. I've been doing a lot of videos lately on YouTube. I'm posting at least two videos a week, if not more. So if you'd like to see more stuff like this, and a whole lot of other tuning and form-related stuff, as well as physical training for the sport of archery, don't be afraid to hit that subscribe button and notification bell to be notified every time a new video is uploaded, because lots of them will be coming out. And ultimately, I'm putting this information out there so you don't have to go through the same growing pains that I did when I was coming up.
You're watching the Jay Kaminsky YouTube channel.
So the most important thing and the most critical thing that you need when doing your nocking point is a bow square. This is an L square in the shape of an L. There's a T square that has the letter T shape form. I'll put a link in the description below on where you can find a simple bow square like this. And there's the metric side and the standard SAE side on the other side as well. So the way that you measure your nocking point is not extremely important for each individual person, meaning however you measure it, as long as you're measuring it consistently the exact same way, you're golden. But when you're talking to your opponents, maybe your friends, whatever you want to call them, if you are saying, I'm running a 5/8 knocking point, you need to tell them from the universal accepted language, okay? So you take your bow square, you click it on your string, and you don't want to just do the one click because it's kind of a far distance away to measure the brace height itself. Give it that second click so it's all the way against the bow square. And then what you're going to want to do, if for me, so when I'm building new bows up, I always actually measure to the top of the button because I use the same plunger. So I make it so the bow square just barely misses, well, it touches the button but misses it, because the nocking point is affected by the height of the actual arrow rest itself. So if it's not in the exact same place that I want it to be, then my nocking point's gonna be in the wrong place. So I actually start, when I'm rough setting up my bow, set it up here, because that's where I've got it documented to as well. But optimally, when you're talking to your friends, you want to lower it so the bow square is just missing your arrow rest itself. You don't want it to be pushing the arrow rest out of the way. You want it to just barely be sitting on the arrow rest. So that's where your zero is. And then you look over and you make note of where the nocking points are, or nocking point if you're only using one, but optimally you'll be using two. So you can use either the top reference or the bottom reference. Either way, just be consistent and the way you reference. Most people will set their nocking point incorrectly, especially in the beginning. They'll set it at the zero. So they'll put the bottom of the nock at zero. So that means the arrow is going to be pushed perfectly straight as the string's being driven forward when you let go of the string. You know, optimally, you'd think that makes best sense. It does with a compound, but not with a recurve. Because with a compound, they're pulling directly behind the arrow. So when they let go, the string is already conformed to the arrow and it just pushes itself forward. With a recurve, we use split finger. One finger above, two below. Or if you're bare bow, three below. So we're not even pulling the string back in the center when we go to let go. And so the string has to then conform to the arrow. And when it does that, it deflects and changes the way the arrow is flexing. So you will need a slightly higher nocking point to compensate for that. Everybody is slightly different. Some people need higher nocking points than others. Some people need lower nocking points than others. Your tiller can affect your nocking height. Your stabilizers can affect your nocking height. So there's a lot of things that can affect it, and dynamically it's best to just set it for you. So some people don't know how to dynamically set their nocking point or how to do bear shaft shooting. I'll do another video specific to bear shafting, but for the sake of this video, because we're talking about nocking point, I'll quickly explain it. The whole idea is you want to shoot fletch shafts and bare shafts. So some fletchings, some arrows without any fletchings at all, just to knock on the arrow. And what that's going to do is it's not going to allow the vanes to steer the arrow and take out any sort of influences that you've been putting into it or that the bow is putting into it as it's being shot. You shoot a flat shaft, then you shoot a bare shaft, you shoot a flat shaft and a bare shaft. I always recommend to do alternating flat shafts and bare shafts. Or if you're really just rough tuning, you can kind of look at the arrow flight. What you want to do is you want the arrow to be coming out of the bow and flying like a dart. You do not want the arrow to come out of the bow and then do this, do a porpoising. So you don't want the arrow to porpoise, which is like a dolphin, up and down. Because if it is, then it might be your nock is too high and the arrow comes out of the bow and does this, or it's too low and it starts hitting low. If you shoot bare shafts, you'll see if your bare shaft hits high or it hits low, you do different things. So all you gotta think about is, if the bare shaft hits higher than the flat shafts, that means your nocking point is too low. So that means the arrow is gonna wanna do this without fletchings. So if your bare shafts hit high, your nocking point's too low. If your bare shaft hits low, your nocking point's too high. I have a book coming out that I'm working on. I've already finished writing it, working on edits right now. It's going to be called Tuning for Performance, so it'll cover all of this stuff. So keep an eye out on this channel for the announcement of when the pre-sale is available for that book. So that's kind of basically what you want to look for tuning your nocking point height. So everybody's setup, everybody's style will require slightly different nocking point heights. My bow setups generally were about the same when I was using the same tab, when I was using the same arrow, the same nock, etc., etc., etc. But as soon as you go to fat arrows for indoors, your nocking point's different. As soon as you go to a biter nock, your arrow nocking points are going to be different. Most people don't know this for some reason, but the biter nocks will require a much higher nocking point than a regular conventional nock. This is because the biter nocks are designed to be asymmetrical. If you look at the internal structure of a biter nock and you look at it from the side profile, so from this way, if you look at the internal structure of the nock itself, I'll put a diagram on the screen, but you'll see that the nock is not flat where the string sits. It's actually angled towards the top. It's got a slope upwards towards the top. And so what that's doing is it's affecting the way the arrow is going to be delivered and pushing on the center line of the arrow. So you need a higher nocking point to compensate for that. Old school methods for why that was if you look at my string, if I use old school technique and use more bottom finger hook than index finger, because I'm using old school T form like this instead of more modern upward hooking tight anchor form, you'll see the string is at an angle that mimics what a biter nock does, right? But if I add more index finger curl, now look at the nock, or the string where the nock is. It's flat, like a regular conventional nock. I have a already fairly high nocking point for some reason. Later in my career when I shot biter nocks, I needed such a high nocking point that my arrow looked like it was almost gonna hit my stabilizer at brace height. So I felt like it was just kind of getting out of hand a little bit too high, and ultimately just went to regular nocks from that point forward to bring my nocking point back down. So there's a few different type of nocking points themselves. You can tie them on like this. So this is this serving that I use here to tie on the nocking points is actually called 3D. It's from BCY. It's a very small, thin material. But it's not like dental floss like some people can use. And it's ideally never use the same thread to tie your nocking points on that your center serving is. Especially if you're using the same center serving that I do, which is the Halo center serving from BCY. It's very slippery, very slick. So if you're tying two slippery things on top of each other, they tend to want to move. Even when you tie the permanent version like these are. I'll do another video in the future showing you exactly how to tie nocking points, how to tie movable ones, and then how to tie permanent ones, and show you all the little details as well to make them absolutely perfect for you. So there are tie-on nocking points, and then there are these type of nocking points that are made of brass. This is typically for a youth type of setup or somebody that is just setting stuff up very quickly, like a cut-rate shop. This is on my daughter's bow. You'll see it's just made of brass and it's crunched on with a pair of pliers, essentially, that are specifically designed for knocking points. I do not recommend these if you're going to do any serious amount of shooting. The main reason for going for the tied knocking points than these brass knocking points as a shooter from mechanical sides of things is because these will tear up your finger tabs very quickly. It'll cut grooves into your leather and it just really tears things up. Ultimately, the tie-down knocking points is much more friendly for your tab. Also, another negative of the brass knocking point is that they are very heavy, especially if you're going to use two of them because you've got twice as much weight there. Brass is already a very dense material, so it weighs a whole lot. And that weight in the center of the string actually changes the tune quite a bit. So with knocking points, you have the option of running one or two. I used to only ever run one when I was shooting, when I was a kid in juniors, basically. Just because I only ever saw people shooting one. But once I got out to the training center, started seeing more and more serious shooters. Typically, I will say the vast majority of high-level shooters shoot two knocking points. That means there's one on top and one on bottom of the arrow. It's not just the top knocking point. That helps make sure that the arrow is always in the same exact place every single time. But a mistake that I see some people shoot that have two knocking points, especially at the club level type of shooter, is they don't have them supporting the knock itself. Your knocking points should be touching your arrow, your knock, just barely. Not crushing them. You don't want them to increase how much pressure it takes to have the arrow come off the string. You just want them supporting the arrow. That way it's always in the exact same consistent spot. It's not important to give it space to breathe. Old school method says, oh, we need to give it space because as you pull back, it wants to pinch the arrow and knock it off the string. The biter knocks have recesses cut into them for that forward sloping angle, but ideally, most people aren't shooting that way anymore anyway. Shooting with knocking points that support the arrow fully should be more accurate and more consistent. Because if you're not putting your arrow on the string the same, that means you're not holding the arrow in the exact, or the string in the exact same place. So therefore you're changing your rear sight and your impact point downrange. So other things that affect your knocking point outside of the actual physical location is your arrow rest. The lower your arrow rest is, the higher your knocking point ends up getting. Another thing is your tiller. If you were to make your tiller split be bigger, tiller split meaning the difference between the upper and lower limbs and the comparison between the two. If I make the split bigger, so if I shorten the bottom dramatically, watch where this knocking point goes. Actually, I'll put an arrow on it and then we'll look at what happens to the actual knocking point. So you'll see as I squeeze the bottom to shorten the bottom tiller, the knocking point lowers. So your tiller also affects the knocking point.
Thanks for watching. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell so you get notified every time a new video is uploaded. For seminar and book info, head to jkaminsky.com or click on the link below. And I appreciate you guys watching. If you would, please share this video. It'd really help get the word back out that I am back out there. Thanks again. Take care.